Good evening, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome each and everyone to this very important consultation discussion. And I know that you've all taken the time to be here. It is important that we all go away feeling that we have been able to be equipped to make contribution in terms of legislation in the United Kingdom. But before I introduce the speakers and how the program is going to run, I'd like to invite all of you to bow as we pray. Let us pray. Our gracious, loving Father, we count it a joy to be in your presence this evening as we look at issues that can have impact on our children and in terms of our ministry in the United Kingdom. Heavenly Father, we have come to share ideas, and we have come to know how we can also make an impact in terms of the laws that are ignited in this country. And so, Lord, we want to invite you, especially as we hear presentations from Mrs. Lorraine MacDonald and also Pastor Brighton Cavallo. We pray your guidance throughout this discussion, and we ask, O Lord, that each of us will be satisfied with what we hear and how we can proceed. And so, Lord, be with us throughout these discussions, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, this is going to be, it's a program that will end at 6 p.m. And the way it's going to go is that we will have, there'll be a brief introduction of our speakers. And also after that, there will be a Q&A. Now, the first presentation will take 35 minutes by Mrs. Lorraine MacDonald, who is the BUC Education Director. Followed by Dr. Brighton Cavallo, who will take 25 minutes to discuss the main parts of the consultation and how we can go about it. And then after that, we'll do the Q&A, which will take about 45 minutes. And we will indulge in your with your participation. And also, please raise your hand through the symbol. I'll be looking for that rather than your physical hands, given that I may not see you if you are not on my screen. So use the symbols on the screen to raise your hands. But I will also require that during the presentations, please hold your comments or raising your hands until the presentation is done. We will start straight away, given that we have limited time for everything that we'll be doing here. Our first speaker is Mrs. Lorraine MacDonald, and she is the BUC Education Director. Now, Lorraine is a senior leader in education, having worked in the sector for over 30 years in primary, second, and secondary school, FE and HE. Her experience includes working in initial teacher training and as an assistant principal examiner. She's also a school governor. Mrs. MacDonald is married with four children, adult children, and she's an active member of the Handsworth Church in Birmingham. Her passion is outreach, evangelism, and also with a desire to see the gospel reach as many people as possible. Now, her spiritual giftedness in leadership, teaching, and administration has been fully utilized in various church departments, especially in personal ministries. Now, after almost 28 years of teaching junior Sabbath school, she continues ministering as a presenter for the Secrets of Prophecy online Bible seminar and teaches Sabbath school in the North England Conference. Having previously worked in Adventist education, it has been Lorraine's desire to return to full-time ministry. However, at this particular time, she is the one overseeing education within the British Union territory. And without saying much, I'd like to welcome Mrs. Lorraine McDonald to begin with the presentation, and she will take 35 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Pastor Davies. It's a pleasure to be here with everyone. I trust that you can see me. If they have spotlighted me to everybody, that will help. But I will also be sharing a PowerPoint, so I'll do that right now. Just want to say welcome to everyone who has become a part of this very important presentation, or well, consultation really. And we are here to try and assist you and answer your questions. And we will work hopefully together and contribute and lend our voice to this consultation. So thank you first to Pastor Kavala for inviting me to be a part of this presentation, as he is leading, of course, in the area of public affairs and religious liberty, and this falls under his remit as well as mine. So let me go in without further ado. I just want to check Pastor Kavala, sorry, Pastor Davies, that you can see my screen.
Yes, indeed, I can see the screen.
Okay,
yeah.
Thank you very much.
I don't know, but if you can raise the volume on your screen a little bit, I think that would be helpful.
Let me see if I can do that for you. Let me just do that now so that I can get a better volume here. Oops, I'm going to stop sharing my screen for a bit so I can do that. Right, let's make this. I've got it almost on full. I don't know if you can hear me any better.
Okay, that is fine.
All right, thank you
exactly.
very much.
Thank
I'll
you.
Start sharing again. Thank you all for your patience as we get try and get this working for you. Okay, let us go again. All right, so welcome once again to everyone who's joining, and those who are joining even as I speak, as we present this very important topic of gender questioning children. Now, when I sent out my article around this topic, I quoted this, and it's a quote that I hold very dear to. Quite often, when things are going wrong, we can be silent, thinking that our voice doesn't count. But this statement always rings true to me. The only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is for good men to do nothing. And many a times during wars, during apartheid, during very various traumatic times on Earth's history, sometimes good men have just kept silent, thinking that was the better thing to do. And so this is why this is so dear to me, that we need to lend our voice to this consultation. We are called to sigh and cry, or as it says in the new NIV, grieve and lament over the detestable things that are done in it. Talking about Jerusalem, but of course, the same thing applies to us in our world. Things are going wrong, legislation is being made, and we are part of this, the community. Our children are part of the community. Some of your children will be in the state system. Some of your children will be in our schools. But we are all being affected by this. And so we need to lend our voice in this consultation to express our views as to how we feel this matter of children and gender questioning. And we will give a definition about that. What do we mean by gender questioning? This is becoming very prominent in all the schools. We will all have to face it one way or another. So I also put this at the end of my quote, on end of my article, because again, it's the idea that we need to speak out, because if we don't speak out for others and speak out for ourselves, when it's time, when we need others to speak out for us, will anybody be there? First they came for the communists and I didn't speak out because I was not a communist. Then they came for the socialists and I didn't speak out because I was not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists and I didn't speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews and I didn't speak out because I was not a Jew. But then they came for me and there was no one left to speak for me. And this is by the pastor, he's a German pastor, Reverend Martin, I don't know how to say his name, Niemeyer, I think. But this is another version of that same, but he puts in there, first they came for the Catholics, but I was a Protestant, so I didn't speak out for them. So all of us we are calling on you to join in speaking out for our children. This is what we are here for today. We've got legislation, particularly for myself, in my position as education director, this legislation that we're going to talk about today has implication for our schools, our Seventh-day Adventist schools, of which we have seven. And we are having to grapple with this. It is going to affect what we do, particularly our secondary school, and I'll speak a little bit more about that. And I'm going to leave this little bit on the screen for the moment. The future of our schools depends on how we support them. And so if you haven't, this survey has been going for a little while, if you haven't had the opportunity to take part in this survey, then either log on the URL at the bottom, or take a snapshot of this so that you can do so later, or you can go to the QR code. It's really important that as many people lend their voices to what will be the future of Seventh-day Adventist education. And we are met with all of these difficulties that the one that we're going to look at today. And people are turning to our schools, and I'll give you an example. So somebody left one of our primary schools to go to a very well sought after secondary school in Watford. And when they got there, the child realized that there was lots of swearing. There was lots of bullying of her because she was very studious. People started to bully her for just being studious. And then finally, she realized that one of her teachers was transgendering or had transgendered. And as a result of that, her parents have chosen to pull her out to send her to our schools. Our schools are in a place now where people who are looking for something alternative are looking to our schools. And we're encouraging you to join in the survey, talk about what you think about our schools and where we're going, what the future of our schools lay by taking this survey. So if you haven't already done so, many of you may already have, and I thank you if you have, please do that. And if you haven't done it in your church, please take a picture of this screen and make sure that it is shared in your church. It will come back up again a bit further on in the presentation towards the end. But it is an important thing that not only do you lend your voice to this consultation, but we need you to lend your voice also to this survey. All right. Just want to give you some little heads up on some exciting things that are happening in our school. For the first time in Adventist history, one of our schools has got outstanding in all areas, outstanding in every single area of the school with no areas of improvement, and that's our school in Newbold. And again, I'm highlighting the fact that we are providing outstanding education, good education in many of our schools. And we are pleased that in December of last year, when off November they came, but the report didn't come out until December and early January, that we have achieved outstanding at our school in Newbold. Not only our school in Newbold, but our school in Birmingham, which is the Harper Bell School. And they, because they are voluntary aided, in other words, they're funded direct from the local authority, have to have an inspection called Section 48, which is how does a school's religious distinctiveness impact pupils' outcomes? And we, again, for the first time in Adventist history, it's never been done before, one of our schools, this is the only school that is VA, has achieved outstanding in its Section 48. Its school's religious distinctiveness impacts pupils' outcomes. And they said, we can't do anything else but give you outstanding. So outstanding education is happening in our schools, and we need you to share that with others who are looking for an alternative because of these issues, one of which we're speaking about today, that is happening in the state sector in particular, but it will affect all of our schools. So we were pleased to do that. There's no other school in the West Midlands area, but our one Church of England school, which I happen to also be in, has received that outstanding Section 48 inspection. So we are praising the Lord for for doing that, but we want you to celebrate with us. And when people are looking for alternatives, recommend our schools, because we are here to provide Christian education. Now, I quite often get asked, well, how do you deal with these issues in our schools? We are, all of our schools are designated as faith schools. And because we're designated as faith schools, we are allowed to present relationships and sex education, human sexuality, according to our faith. And I get asked this a lot, so I'm putting it up right here now. We are allowed to present these matters. We're not hiding from it. We can't bury our heads in the sand and pretend that it's not happening. We do so with love and respect for other people who make other choices. But we are allowed to teach it according to our faith. So I'm sure that will be a question that will be asked quite, as it is everywhere I go, people ask me that question. So let me just put that out there. I may need to share that again as others join. We are allowed to teach it according to our faith. We are doing a lot of work around this to make sure that we get it right. Also, this is going to affect our teachers, not just the teachers here in our schools, but, and I've sent out this the link to this presentation to teachers who have joined the Adventist Educators Association, because this will affect you as teachers. And again, we're going to talk about who this legislation is directed at. It will affect you. And how are you going to deal with this? And so part of my role as education director is to support teachers in the mainstream sector. So if you are not already joined to the Adventist Educators Association, or it is formerly known as the Adventist Teachers Association, then please do join. Again, scan the QR code, or you may take the URL there. Again, share it with others who are in your sphere of influence. Get them to join. We're going to be doing some work with you, hopefully later on in the year, but I'll talk about that on another occasion. So if you join the database, you will get to hear about how we will support you, particularly around this area of relationships and sex education and gender, children's questioning about gender, how we support you with that. So do join us there. So there's a little bit of an introduction before we get into the presentation, because it is important that we're all singing from the same hymn sheet. So let's get right into it now. In the short time that I've been allotted, gender questioning and children, this is what we're looking at today. So as I said, what we need is your voice. We often ask for pupil voice, and sometimes, particularly in legislation, we have to be the voice for our children. And this is about speaking up, speaking out, and lending our voice where we have opportunity. So this is what we've called you here to do today, is to guide you and direct you on how you can give your voice, lend your voice to this very important consultation. So here are the aims, which we hope to do. I'm going to give a brief explanation about the consultation and its implications. And we will be looking at ways to answer the consultation, go on to the website and answer the consultation. I'm going to be looking at pages 5 to 10 of the guidance, and Pastor Kavala will look at pages 11 to 20 of the guidance. And then, as Pastor Davis has said, we will take your questions. If you wish to, ahead of the time, I'm hoping this is okay to say, Pastor Davis, put your questions in the chat, and we will try and capture them that way. Yes, we'd like you to raise your hands, but if you put them in the chat, we will try to facilitate being able to take those questions. And what we can't answer today, we will try and answer either through email or through other means. So we need to hear what you're thinking. Do put it into the chat, but we will also have the question and answer section at the end. Okay, so it's been more than 5 years since the government first promised schools that they were going to give us some guidelines on issues including what toilets and changing rooms people could use, where they sleep on residential trips, and when to involve parents. Okay, but there's been a lack of transgender guidance for schools for ages. Now, I'm using the term transgender here, but you'll see me changing it, and I'll explain again why that is. So we've been waiting for this, and on September of last year, they started talking about it again, that the transgender guidance is needed in schools. This is what the parents were telling the BBC, because of course, they wanted to see how schools would best support their children if they have children who may be struggling in this area. But what are the implications of this this consultation and the guidance which has now come out? It's got implication for our schools. I've already said that. As the education director, it's got huge implication for our schools, particularly because we have a boarding school. Our Stanborough Secondary School is a boarding school with 100 boarding places, and we are reopening the school in September of 2024. We will reopen the boarding school, but there are boarding school standards that we have to meet, and we will be having to look at how we deal with people who may thinking, maybe questioning their gender and what that means and what the implications of that are. But in a wider context, it can affect us as a church in different ways. Pathfinders, when they go camping, we hopefully offer our pathfinding to the community. And there may be children within the midst of the community who are thinking along those lines, who may be joining our pathfinders. But I want us to be careful to think that it's not just about people coming in, yeah, but it's also about children within our midst who are thinking that way. Our own children may be questioning their gender. So I don't want you to think of that, oh, it's just when people come in. No, 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 no. It's both within and, of course, in the community. Children's ministry, again, an outreach path, youth ministry, family ministry, pastoral ministry. And you might think, oh, how does that affect the pastoral ministry? Well, you may have parents coming to you as pastors. Any of you pastors will be listening to this presentation or are currently on the platform. As pastors, you may be questioned, how do I support my child? What do I do? Have you got the skills to support children? Camp meeting. Again, we open our camp meeting. I'm a firm believer of evangelism. And all people of every faith and none of every persuasion may come to our camp meetings, may come to anything that where we have overnight stay and where young people in the community are involved. And we need to think about how do we manage this issue of gender questioning. So just to get straight in, the consultation has already started, but it closes on the 12th of March. So Tuesday, the 12th of March, this consultation will close. If you haven't received or seen the article on the BUC News that has all the links in there, this is the link that I've put on the screen. Again, you may want to capture it. I'm going to ask if somebody can capture it. I may do it whilst Pastor Cavallo is speaking, and I will drop this link into the chat so that you can click directly from the chat into the actual consultation document. So it's a draft document at this moment, open for consultation, and then you can lend your voice by scrolling down to the bottom of that first page and you'll see the continue button. So once you click on the continue button, you can then start answering the questions and so on. Now, there is some guidance that is being given. This is the actual guidance as it looks. Again, this is the website where you can find that information. All right, so we're going to put all of this into the chat so that you can look at it. Let me go back again. That's the page where you find the information. This one here, that's the page. And this is the guidance itself, and it's called Gender Questioning Children. All right. So when you're filling in your form on from this page, when you go onto here to add your voice, when you click on continue at the bottom, have this beside you so that you can fill in and read, respond to each page or each statement or each section. So do again capture this. We'll put it into the chat in a moment for you to look at, so that you can click on it and go there directly. Now, something to note is that you do not have to answer every question, and you don't need to do it all at the same time. Okay, so you can save your response and come back to later. It's going to take about an hour, for, you know, if you're going methodically going through every single question, and you may wish to do that. Some have already done so. But some people, depending on what your computer skills are, you may get through to a lot quicker. Or if you've already looked at the consultation, you already have your answers prepared. So around about an hour, you might want to set aside. But as I said, you don't need to do it all in one go. You can just take your time and go through. So if for any reason you've found that yourself that you're on the last day, the 12th of March, and it's about to close, and you think, oh my goodness, I haven't done it, then these are the sections you want to respond to. Okay, the most important section is responding to requests and engaging parents. And these are questions 15 to 18. So if you don't do anything else at all, please make sure that you do that section because that's what we need. Then, of course, in order for your voice or your response to be secured, you need to click on the submit button, finish and submit your consultation when you've completed all the sections that you want to do. But we're encouraging you to respond to the requests and engaging parents section. All right. So I wanted just to make out again a point here that the term transgender is not used in this consultation. Okay. The term transgender is not used because under UK law, children cannot obtain what's known as a gender recognition certificate, and therefore they can't legally change their sex. All right. So here you're seeing we're using the term children questioning their gender, and that's why it's called the gender questioning children. That's what the guidance is about. And so when we think of child or children, we were referring to anyone under the age of 18. So this can affect people going to college, sixth form, as well. All right. So we're not going to refer to these children as transgender children because they're not. Any child that may be having a may be questioning or rethinking of what about gender, we can only refer to them as questioning their gender and not transgender. So that's an important point when you use when you fill in the form. Do not be using that term transgender because that doesn't apply to children and young people under the age of 18. Okay, so what is the guidance about? Yeah, I've given a little bit about it, but this is what it states on the website. This guidance provides practical advice which the DfE expects schools and colleges to follow in response to requests for changes from children who are questioning their agenda. All right, that's what this is all about. It aims to support schools and colleges to make lawful decisions based on individual circumstances, and it will also help parents understand what schools and colleges can and can't do to accommodate. All right, this is why we were trying to get this out to as many people as we can, parents, teachers, and anyone that's involved working with young people in our church and maybe outside of our church too. So that's what the guidance is about. I want to make you realize that we're not covering what children are taught about the topic of gender reassignment. We're not covering that today. Some of you may wish to ask those questions, but this today is not about that. If time permits at the very end, you may be able to ask us some questions. But the thing that we are focusing on is children who are questioning their gender identity. So that's what we're looking at today, not so much what is taught in the RSHE, that's Relationships and Sex and Health Education curriculum. We're not covering that today, only if time permits at the end. So the Department of DfE will include another guidance about teaching this as it will be updating its statutory guidance in the not too distant future. And there'll be a revision of the guidance coming out. And at that point, there may be need for us to have another discussion around this area. But today is about children and young people who may be questioning their gender. All right. Now, I want to put this up because in the article that I published or asked to be published in the BUC News, I made reference to this website. This is an organisation called Christian Concern. And the leader of Christian Concern is someone that I'm working with in various other areas, They also do have something called Christian Schools Trust, which is not for like Catholics and Church of England schools, but other schools, other denominations like us who have got little schools and are trying to present to run faith-based schools that are biblically based. So Christian Concern is the legal arm of all things to do with Christian and Christian schools. And so they have taken a lead on this. Again, this is the website that I did put in the article, but it's also here on your screen. Again, we will post this. If our hosts can do so, we will post this in there, because they've given what is, I think, a very, very good guidelines on how to answer the questions. And they've said, right, when you get to question number this, these are the kinds of things you can say in your own words. So they're not telling you to necessarily use their words, but these are the things that you may want to wish. This is the language you might wish to use. These are the aspects of the question that you may need to consider. So you might read the question and not fully understand it, but this is what it is. So if you go onto this website, you will see what is it's about a 9-page document, some further guidance from a Christian perspective as to how to respond to some of those questions. So they've been ahead of a game. They're already ahead of the game, and we are almost trailing behind. And we have been trailing behind in this whole issue about human sexuality. And it's time for us now to lend our voice, as I've said. We need to be hearing about it, talking about it amongst ourselves as Christians in a loving and Christian way with meekness and respect. Because it's here, whether we like it or not, it's in our community, and believe it or not, it is in our church. Let's not hide that. It is within our church. And so we need to be ahead of the game if, where possible, so that we are prepared to give an answer as God has asked us to do so. So who is this guidance for? Again, you can read most of this on the screen. As it says there, it's mainly for schools. But you can see proprietors of independent schools, that's us. We, the BUC, run 7 Adventist schools, independent school. Well, 6 independent schools, and 1 is a voluntary aided school. So it applies to us, both point number one. Well, all of them actually apply to us, but I want to just bring out the fact that this is how it, you know, directly affects us. You can see there teachers and other school staff and school nurses, that those are nurses that come into our schools, but also you have hospital schools, and so they may have to think about this as well. Of course, it applies to the head teachers and principals. And then, whilst they've referred to it as diocese, our union is the diocese in Catholic or COV speak. So the diocese and other faith representatives involved in the management and supervision of our schools. So this is who this guidance is for. And we've been given the opportunity to lend our voice. And so, as I said, we're encouraging you to get on and lend your voice. And hopefully this presentation, along with the documentation that you can find on the Christian Concern website, and some of what we will share today, will help you to fill in the guidance in an appropriate way. There are other legal obligations as schools and as a church. We have to abide by these acts, the Equality Act 2010, the Human Rights Act 1998, and the GDPR, which was used to call data protection. And then there's a raft of education legislation. So these are part of our legal obligations as people who run schools. But as I said, there are other areas of our church where children and young people, not about just their learning, but those who take part in our activities that we present within our church, may fall under this guidance as well. Okay, I'm hoping that's clear. So what should I say? And as I said, this meeting today is about what helping you to determine what you are, what you can say. So there is a section, the first two sections of the consultation, about 10 questions are about yourself. But they're not asking you to put your name. And that's very similar to the questionnaire that I put out there. I've not asked for your name, but I do want to know, are you a mother? Are you a father? Are you a parent? Are you a grandparent? Are you a teacher? Are you a governor? Are you a pastor? And so you'll be asked various bits of information that you need to put in, but your name isn't there. So it's totally anonymous. You can put your name if you wish to, but you can request that your response is kept totally confidential. All right, so that it's anonymous and nobody knows. If that's the way you choose to complete the guidance, then you can go ahead and do so anonymously. Okay, so as I come to the end of my section, there's some overarching principles that start from page 6. And again, a little bit of the terminology that is being used. This is about gender identity ideology. As I said, we're not talking about what is the curriculum and the LGBTQ and human sexuality in and of itself. This is what it's about, the gender identity ideology, where a person or feels that they can have a gender, whether male, which is man or female, or other, which is different to their biological sex. So this is what this is about. Children, young people who feel that they are different to their biological sex. Now, there's a lot of contest. This is being contested, this belief. It's been heavily contested, but we have to address it nevertheless. All right. So parents and children might be coming to your school if you're a teacher. Your children may be in schools where children are coming. And in the article that I shared on the BUC News, it spoke about where the Christian Concern got involved with a family who were doing just that. They were questioning what was happening in their child's school, where a six-year-old boy, I think it was asking to, you know, it certainly was a primary school child, was questioning their gender. All right. So parents and children might ask a school or a college to accommodate a child who's questioning their gender. And Dr. Kavala will talk a bit more about the areas that that's going to affect in schools and places of learning. There's 5 principles that this guideline is asking proprietors of schools to consider. Schools and colleges have statutory duties to safeguard and promote the welfare of all children. So this week, not this weekend, on Thursday and Friday, I was at the Christian Schools Trust with the gentleman that I spoke about, Steve Bigu of the Christian Concern. He's the head of education there. And part of the, because we had this discussion as well, and part of the discussion was around the idea that I might in my church school say, this is the biblical worldview, and this is how we speak about how we believe the Bible teaches human sexuality. But there may be a subgroup or a small group, maybe even just one child in your school who doesn't believe that, which is, and we as in our church schools explain, this is the way we are going to teach RSC according to our faith. But that child may be experiencing anxiety. And this is where they start to talk about, are we safeguarding that child? We have to make sure that child's not being bullied, as point number 2 says. Schools and colleges should be respectful and tolerant places where bullying is never tolerated. Now, what is bullying? We won't spend too much time on that. But a child might feel anxiety when you said, my mom says I can't play with you. Yeah. What you're doing is your parents are, or what you're thinking of. And we think about the Brianna, and I can't remember her surname, incident that has happened. All right. That's big in the news at the moment. And that would have started around bullying first before the tragedy happened. So parents should not be excluded from the decisions taken by a school or college relating to requests for a child to socially transition. Now, this is where the guidance needed to come out. You've got people, parents, particularly teenagers, not always just teenagers, because it can be very young children who come into school and tomorrow they want to be not known as John, they want to be known as Joanna, and so on. So they're questioning their identity. Do we as staff, or do we as the church, a child has disclosed or made reference in Pathfinders about their concern? Do we just keep it to ourselves as a school, in particular, because we're talking about schools, or do we include the parents? And of course, we believe that parents need to be involved. And the guidance says parents should not be excluded from those decisions, whether they think, oh, no, this is a child's right to come and speak to me and disclose how they're feeling about something. It might be in a pastoral meeting, in a mentoring meeting. The parents need to be involved. All right, and Pastor Cabral will talk a bit more about that. Schools and colleges have specific legal duties that are framed by a child's biological sex. I'm going to let Pastor Cabral explain that a bit more. But what does that mean, just in principle, in brief? There are certain things that, as schools, we have to know a child's biological sex. Yeah, if something has happened to that child and we had to rush them to a hospital because of something that's happened into the school, we aren't going to say, oh, this is what the child prefers to be known as. No, no, we have to say, this is the child's biological sex. So in the admissions paper and in our registration, we have to know the child's biological sex, regardless of what they may wish to be known and referred to as. So that's one of those, another legal duty that schools, it's not that we discard their preference. And of course, there is no general duty to allow a child to social transition. Yeah, there's no general duty to allow, we say, all right, that's what we think, that's what little Sally wants to do, then we will just go along with it. There's no general duty to allow a child to socially transition. All right, so those are the principles that this guideline is based around, which is in many ways, particularly for us as in faith groups, some of these things are just what we want to hear. You know, we want parents to be involved when children start talking about these things. Yeah, and again, Pastor Kowal will touch a bit more on that. So you're going to see some language in there, and I'm not going to, because I can see that my time is practically gone. And so when you get the guidelines, you will see, particularly on pages, let me just get to it in front of me, pages 7, I think it's just page 7, is all of the language and terminology is given. Gender identity, gender questioning, the broad term that might describe children and young people who are asking questions about their biological sex and perceived gender identity. Remember, they're just asking questions at this point. Gender distressed or confused. That's another term. The social transition, this idea that changes are or adjustments are being made to enable the child to socially transition. Gender incongruence is also mentioned, and gender dysphoria, which is a similar diagnostic term to describe gender incongruence. Yeah, a medical term for a marked and persistent incongruence between an individual's experienced gender identity and their biological biological sex. That's what we call gender incongruence. And so people who experience this gender incongruence, this tension between what they believe they are and what their biological sex is, if they've been doing this for more than 6 months, it is possible to have a diagnosis called gender dysphoria. So I haven't put all of that because it would have been a lot to put on the screen, but do go into the if you're not sure about this, do read the guidance on page 7, where all of that terminology is described. We're trying to work together as a church, the school, home and church. That's why we're here for. My time is gone, so I'm not going to spend too much time talking about this. I want to remind you, if I don't get the time to get it to say so at the end, we need you to fill in the survey about our schools. If you've only joined since I've started this presentation, this was put up at the beginning. We need you to respond to our survey about the future of our schools so that we can say people want our schools. And let me tell you, people do. As I said earlier on, people are from the community are joining our schools because they're looking for something different to what mainstream school is offering them. And we hope that you too may be able to do that as well. All right, so I'm now going to stop sharing my screen and hand over back to Pastor Davies as we move into the next section. Thank you very much, Pastor Davies, and to all of you listening. Put your questions in the chat or raise your hand towards the end. Are we separating the questions at this point, Pastor Davies, or are we going to do all the questions at the end? I have to say, I wasn't absolutely clear.
Yes, we'll take all the questions at the end. So
at the end, okay. So keep your questions. If you haven't put them in the chat, keep your questions, or write them down, and we will take them at the end. Thank you very much for listening. I'm hoping that that's given you a little bit of context as to what this is all about. Pastor Kavala, Brother Sam Davies will, Pastor Sam Davies will take us to the next section. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you very much, Mrs. Lorraine MacDonald for the in-depth presentation. And I believe that all of us have, you know, got a broader idea of what this presentation is about and this consultation is about. We'll listen to our next speaker, and I'll say it is a delight to introduce our next speaker, presenter, Dr. Brighton Cavallo. Dr. Brighton Cavallo comes with many hats, a background in theology, and then he later attained the Master of Theology and PhD degrees in ecclesiastical history, both from the University of Edinburgh. Let me say that it was at Edinburgh University that his interest developed in religious liberty during his church, his studies in church, state, and society lectures at the university. He later studied and completed an MA degree in international studies and diplomacy at the Center for International Studies and Diplomacy, University of London. Subsequently, he pursued a course in international legal studies at Duncan House, the Law School of the University of East London, and was successfully awarded a Master of Laws, LLM, degree with distinction. A year later, he completed an extramural diploma in legal studies, focusing on human rights and European Union law, and graduated also with distinction from Birkbeck College, University of London. Let me say that Dr. Cavallo has served in pastoral ministry for over 35 years. And during those years, he has also served as Ministerial Association Secretary for the South England Conference and the British Union Conference of our church. He is currently the Religious Liberty and Public Affairs Director for the South England Conference. So, ladies and gentlemen, my pleasure to present to you our next speaker, Dr. Brighton Cavallo. And he will take about 25 minutes, taking us through how we can go about understanding the consultation. Pastor Cavallo, over to you.
Oh, thank you very much, Pastor Sam DeVise, and also to our BUC Education Director for that insightful presentation regarding social transitioning in gender questioning children in England. This government consultation in section 3 of its guidance, it deals with what is called overarching principles. They would like us to appreciate the principles as guidelines to respond to this consultation. I believe strongly that we too, albeit we'll be talking generally, but very specifically as Seventh-day Adventists, albeit I'm very mindful there may be those who are online who may not be to this persuasion, I appreciate, and we are privileged to have you. I think you will also appreciate that we have to be guided by principle. This consultation is being guided by principle. I've selected Matthew chapter 10, 16. The words of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ says, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves." A powerful principle. God's people will be found in challenging circumstances. Don't press a panic button, Jesus said. Seize that as an opportunity. To do what? To be wise and harmless. Because let's see the consultation as not something meaning to do us harm, but good. To share some information that would be helpful. And I would want to believe when Jesus said this, he realized that when we trust him, what seemed to be a challenge will be a great witness. Along with that, another biblical principle, 1 Peter 3:15, first in the New King James Version, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. In the Amplified Bible, just below it says, but in your hearts, set Christ apart as holy. Acknowledge him as Lord. Always, not even when you choose, always be ready to give not just a verbatim response, but a logical defense to anyone who asks you to account for the hope that is in you. But to do it how? Courteously and respectfully. There'll be areas I'll be raising in this consultation already out there being debated. It is not a cause for us to respond in any way, particularly when you put God first and you are logical in your defense. You have, in the end, to provide those with courtesy and respect. And as I go through this, may I impress myself and each one of us as we respond to this consultation, that we will do so with courtesy and respect to those who have approached us for consultation. That said, indeed, today's consultation we are dealing with has not come from nowhere. It's a follow-on, our education director rightly presented a moment ago. In 2018, 2019, relationships education, relationships and sex education and health education, if I may say, relationships education geared for primary pupils, relationships and sex education for secondary, but then health education for both, I want you to see the difference, was a statutory guidance, meaning it is a must and enforced by law. It's a statutory guidance. What we are dealing with, you'll see, gender questioning children is a non-statutory guidance. What's the difference? Well, a statutory guidance is a must and it is enforced by law. What we are dealing with is a non-statutory guidance. This is not a must, but a should as expected. So it must not be underplayed because, oh, well, it's non-statutory. It's not through the process of parliament. No, the expectation from the Department of Education is a should be followed at some point. Maybe, as rightly said, maybe passed through parliament. Gender questioning children, non-statutory guidance, okay? This consultation was published on the 19th of November and closes on the 12th of March, 2024. I only have a limited time. So I may skip some areas. to give ample time for Q&A. So you see me go through quickly. Look at that. Someone may say to me, Pastor, gender questioning children. Really? Never heard of that. This is a big issue, you know. Really? Okay, it's a big issue. But let me also find out from you, what is the real issue behind the big issue? This is where I'll be heading. For us not just to appreciate, ooh, and press a panic button, a big issue, but what is the real issue? What's the real issue behind the big issue? Oh, I have some. Let me just count. Something is shedding me a little bit. Okay. Well, we'll see. Now, you will see to some degrees, I'm being kind of well, but as long as you can see the whole screen, what you are seeing in front of you is a statement or a foreword from the Department of Education, but primarily those who have raised this consultation. Okay. They are wanting us to realize what is the real issue. I'm being shaded. Pastor Davis, can I be made clear to read fully? I can see just faces. Okay, I may have to take my document. Give me a minute. I'll read it from my document.
Okay.
I'll just read it from my document. Otherwise, I don't want to. My apologies. Okay. Sorry, I'm just having to. Okay. What do you have in front of you? Okay, I'm okay now. Oh, please take off. Yeah, just take it off. I have the document and I'll read it from my document. The foreword or introduction. Oh, something keeps on coming up. Oh, sorry. Let me read. In the foreword, it states, schools are facing requests to take actions such as changing names, uniforms, or using different facilities to help a child appear more like the opposite sex. With the expectation, and please mark that, because in law, every word counts. So this is not legally binding yet, but it's written with precision. The child to appear the opposite sex with the expectation that they will be treated as if they are. Okay? So it's not just a transition, but with an end in sight. This is often referred to as social transitioning. This guidance, let me move on. Thank you so much. Right. Now, you should know where it is coming from. Very important, like our BUC director, make sure you read the guidance before you begin to respond. That will be provided. Very important. We are now consulting on this guidance and we welcome responses. Thank you so much. responses from the likes of parents, teachers, head teachers, pupils, and clinicians. Nothing is more important than keeping children safe, and we are grateful to all those who will help us get this right. You and I are responding to the Department of Education that they get this thing right. The authors, you have them there, the Right Honorable Gillian Keegan, MP, Secretary of State for Education, and Kemi Badenoch, you know, she is the business secretary, but she is involved in this as the Right Honorable Kemi Badenoch, MP, as Minister for Women and Equalities. This consultation have their insignia. Okay. Let me move from where our education director rightly and ably guided us. We come to the section of structure and overall guidance. The question is posed. This section covers overall structure of the guidance and asks about what your views are and the possible implementation issues for schools and colleges. Okay. What are they? And the questions have been asked. Do you think the structure of the guidance is easy to follow? I've said no. And I'll give reasons for it. You may say yes or I don't know, but I'm just giving you an idea where, when responding, read the guidance and even read between the lines. Is it easy to follow? No. Why? Well, look at that. Section 3. Parents should not be excluded from decisions taken by a school or college relating to requests for a child to socially transition. I go back to what Lorraine McDonald has said. There are good points in this consultation. And thumbs up. It was a time parents were being barred, but look to where I've highlighted. Parents should not be excluded. The school should not just take off and beginning to deal with your child from Monday to Friday when this issue has been raised. Where a child requests action from a school or college in relation to any degree of social transition, schools and colleges, here again, should engage parents as a matter of priority. Thumbs up. Give it a thumbs up. So, Pastor Cavallo, what made you to say the guidance is not easy to follow when they have given principles? Look to what comes first. They are engaging parents and encourage the child to speak to their parents, other than in exceptional, rare circumstances where involving the parents would constitute a significant risk of harm to the child. Almost at that point, don't involve the parents. Oh, I said no, put it in red. Don't go behind it. And I would give reasons for that. A school cannot just take on the role of a parent. Possibly, as I'll come to the very end, engage with professional, social, possibly even religious experts than a teacher, thinking a parent is a risk, so I will take it on. That is not clear to me. There is ambiguity, almost bringing yes, and then later on putting a red line to a parent and saying, we'll take it on upon ourselves. Let me move on. Another area is schools and colleges have specific legal duties that are framed by a child's biological sex. While legislation exists that allows adults to go through a process to change their legal sex, indeed, children's legal sex is always the same as biological sex. If you look into the document itself, it's talking more of social transitioning, gender changes. I would have loved very much that guidance be properly given. And my take will be for the Department of Education to make no mistake that the child's sex is indeed merely and indeed in the birth that it was given. Another area that is a bit of a gray area. If a school or college decides to accommodate a request, a cautious approach should be taken that complies with legal duties, okay? But look to where they're coming from. Some forms of social transition will not be compatible with schools and colleges' statutory legal responsibilities. Education Department, make that clear. It's one way or the other. Almost like, indeed, we agree the legal aspect, but we may come up to areas that may not apply to that. So the things that I've just, you know, raised are any ambiguities. Don't just go through them, but address them, seek to address them. This was brought to our attention. Gender identity and gender questioning. I won't spend much time. I think our director spent some time. If you look at that, the language seems as if it's different, but not different. Gender identity, gender questioning. Okay, gender you may have identified. Gender questioning, you are still in the process. But a child will not just arrive at the end of questioning because it knows the implications. I'll tell you why. When we come to another section, responding to requests and engaging parents, which is good. This section covers parents and carers involved and asks me and you for our views. What is it? Or something is high. Does this section, such whatever, help schools and colleges support children? Does the guidelines provided? I said no. They don't. How? how schools and colleges should handle decisions that impact on the wider school and college. I said not in schools and colleges for reasons from a legal perspective. See where I marked? You may want to mark somewhere else, but I'll give my reasons. You may want to say, oh, well, I don't mind something else, but all I'm trying to raise some things that between the lines may not be self-evident. Why? In this country, Gender Recognition Act 2004 legitimized that you can change your gender. Legitimized that you can change your gender. And I accept. But can I submit to you, what I was bringing up later, can I submit this to you, that I have, as a Seventh-day Adventist also, the law of God, who also created and provided male and female. Folk, this is maybe a big issue, but there's also behind this a real issue. And as I've gone online already, as our BUC director rightly shared, transgender identity is a contested area. Possibly to some one direction, but I can assure you, from a biblical perspective. Now, let me move on. The Gender Recognition Act, what does it say? Well, you can change your gender from a male to a female because Parliament said so. Let me repeat. You can change your gender from a female to a male, but this is the criteria embedded in the Act. Number one, those who are 18 years and over can change. Okay. Two, they must be diagnosed as gender dysphoria, as gender confused. C, they must have lived in that condition for 2 years of confusion. D, they must prove, as now they decide to change, that they will live in that state until they die. You can't change backwards and forwards. If you want to be a woman to a man, you'll be allowed by the government until you die. E, gender recognition panel of experts must be involved. And having gone through that, then at the end, you will receive your certificate. Giving up your biological sex certificate for this one. But I want you to see, I'll come to that. I want you to see this, not from you, not from me, but this is from the Government Equalities Office, trans people in the UK. Read. Trans, look, not transgender, not transsocial. You didn't write this, and neither did I. See, trans is a general term for people whose gender is different from the gender assigned to them at birth. For example, a trans man is someone that transitioned from a woman to a man. Trans people do not feel comfortable living. For example, a trans man is someone that transitioned from a woman to a man. trans people to not feel comfortable living as the gender that they were born with. They take serious life-changing steps to change their gender permanently. But look to the children. Children are not put at risk. See where they are coming from. Well, reform to the Gender Recognition Act will not change the legal rights of trans children. The minimum age for legal gender recognition is 18, aligned with full rights and responsibilities of adult citizenship, and the government has no intention of changing this. Look at the very bottom in red. Trans minors, that means from 18 downwards, I take it, only receive treatment while receiving ongoing psychological support. Very important to our consultation. Okay, they may not be 18, but they are below. They are going through some changes that cannot be underestimated. This is my conclusion. That's my conclusion. Notably, the Gender Recognition Act 2004 gives legal recognition to the transgender, allowing them to require a new birth certificate. And thus, according to full recognition of their acquired gender in law for all purposes, including marriage. Look, my submission, folks. Hence, in my humble opinion, the children socially transitioning in schools and colleges should be solely attended to by their parents, round one, professionals, round two, or preferably by social or medical experts, but certainly not their schools or teachers. They may identify, but a teacher must not be there to see the process from Monday to Friday, the best part of their lives, and thinking they will go through to their parents where there'll be a risk. I said no for legal reasons because some extent for this. Okay. The relationships and sex education. The relationships, whatever, of that first legal, I referred to you, statute earlier. The schools can teach lesbianism, transgenderism, LGBT. On section 37, this is what the teachers must teach by law. By law in schools. Let me read it to you. Schools should ensure that all their teaching is sensitive and age appropriate in approach and content at the point at which schools consider it appropriate to teach their pupils about LGBT. They should ensure that this content is fully integrated into their programs of study for this area of curriculum, rather than delivered in a standalone unit or else. Schools are free to determine how they do this. And in red, We expect all pupils to have been taught LGBT content at a timely point as part of this area of curriculum. I want you just to imagine, here is a little boy going through, or a little girl going through socially what? Transitioning from a man to a woman, woman to a man. And she's sitting in class where this statement, will this make her, will this help her make a decision of social transitioning or even embed, I'm going the right direction? Something to think about. If the social transitioning is just taken in school, there may be a point where it is referred, but to me, quickly, when that child has been identified, must be moved to social, medical, or experts than a school teacher who just possibly may have, sorry for being this, may have just taught LGBT and being there to support in the long term. It's something to think about. Why in the schools, there are many organizations that support that way. Just a few of them. These are folk who are supporting that way. Your role and mine is not to refuse what the child is going through, but how best this child should be taken off from that state. As I conclude, registration of name and sex will come in changing names, will come in pronouns, or I've now called a she, whereas I was a he. Single sex spaces and rooms. Possibly as I conclude on this, do you know, even now, the law has not changed for single-sex spaces, albeit this is a hot issue. Can you imagine a child below 18, possibly 10 years, 11 years, going that direction? And possibly just, I don't know what the method will be like, but being given a go-ahead to go through single-sex spaces, a boy and a girl, about 11 years, in the same toilet, in the same bathroom. These are the areas as you respond. Is that right or wrong? Yes or no? Physical education, implications, single-sex schools. And that one, very interesting. Okay. At the end, you'll be asked to provide, general comments. I'm concluding on this. And I'll be responding, but I'll bring a biblical element because they're asking me to share with them the right way. Genesis, chapter 1. God provided everything, but look at 27. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created him, male and female created he them. I will not deny the implications of transgenderism or social transitioning. But may I conclude that, and with courtesy, with respect, they are anti-God. Why are they anti-God? Because of Genesis 1:27. I respect the law of the land wholeheartedly. But way I'll be responding to the consultation, I also want to make it plain to the Department of Education that there is a living God who created male and female. And I cannot, through social transitioning or transgendering, teach my child that they will change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Cavallo, for simplifying the main parts of the consultation and also for enabling us to understand how to contribute. Before that, we heard from Mrs. Lorraine MacDonald, the British Union Conference Education Director, who provided a context for understanding this consultation. As promised earlier on in the program, we will spend the next 30 to 40 minutes answering any questions you may have and also providing additional information on how to respond to the consultation and the government document being reviewed. Please put questions in the chat box to ensure they are addressed in an organized manner. I know I did say earlier on that raise your hands, but given the numbers, we have 100 people on this Zoom meeting. I think the best thing would be to write your questions in the chat and then I'll take it from there. I will begin by addressing the questions previously asked in the chat. And the first one is, do the teachers at our Seventh-day Adventist schools need to make students aware of relationships?
The car, it can drive?
Yes.
How much? Yeah, that's a little.
Somebody needs to unmute. Okay, thank you. Let me begin again. Do the teachers at our Seventh-day Adventist schools need to make students aware of relationships, types of families that are not in accordance with God's words? If so, what age do you teach this from? The person says, I hope my question is clear and I understand you would teach it from a biblical perspective.
Do you wish me to take that question?
Yes. Lorraine MacDonald, is it? Can you respond to this?
Yes, I will. What I'm going to ask our hosts to do, if you can tag or our screens, then we can see all three of us, myself, Dr. Cavallo, okay, and Brighton, if that would help. If you're able to add a spotlight at the different spotlights, it will help us. All right. The answer to that question is, do we teach that? Let me just, because I was putting off the question. Do the teachers at our SDS schools need to make students aware? As I said, there is a statutory, some guidance on us teaching relationships and sex education. We have to abide by, as schools, we abide by what is known as the independent school standards. And we also have the Ofsted inspection framework. And a reference is made to the teaching of sex relationships and sex education and human sexuality, different relationships. There are references made to that. Now, there's a huge process in so doing. The answer is yes, but let me give you the context in which we do it. We are teaching from a biblical worldview. That's the first thing to be made clear. All right, we do teach from a biblical worldview. We are putting together, we are still in the process of putting together a curriculum that is completely supported by scripture, that is in the process. It hasn't been done before in our church. So we are in the process of working on that. Dr. Carvalho and myself, we held an inset day in October of last year for all teachers so that they know. And we have agreed between us as schools, what will be taught at what age. So in the young age, it will just be talking about different types of families, but we always talk from the biblical world view. And that's the point to be making out. We have not decided to bury our heads in the sand. We are putting it out there, this is what God's desire for human relationships is. This is what it is. However, there are others who believe something different. We're not offering a smorgasbord of make a choice, which one you'd like to follow. What we are notifying or highlighting at different ages, that different relationships exist. Now, and it is all age appropriate. We have spent some time making sure that there is symmetry between all the schools, that at this age we teach this, at year one we teach this, and so on and so forth, right up until year six. And then, of course, we have our secondary school, and we talk about it in different ways there. So the answer to your question is yes, our SDA schools do make students aware of relationships and types of families that are not in accordance with God's word, but not from a point of view of choosing. We are notifying that there are other families. Now, the reason why we do this, we, as I said, we can't bury our heads in the sand. I'll give you an example. During lockdown, lots of families from my church, we used to walk through the park. And we were walking through the park, there in the car were two ladies embracing and cavorting, as you might say. Now, a child walked past that car. When they saw that happening, they're going to ask a question. And so you're going to explain that, of course, this is not what God's ideal is. What we're trying to teach children to do, what Pastor said it about us in answering the questions, is that they do so when they see difference, they do so respectfully. We don't put down people, we don't demonize them or anything like that. It's not in accordance with God's will, it's not in accordance with the biblical worldview, it's not in accordance with your family values. However, we do not demonize, we do not and you saw the term that could be used, that people are being bullied or being put under anxiety or stress because their view, their family setup may be different to our family setup. And remember, it is right in our midst. If we are a school that is inviting people from the community, then there's a possibility that people of different persuasions may come into our schools, as well as children within our schools questioning their own identity. So I hope that answers the question. And I can be contacted further, you know, to go into details about, you know, our curriculums if people are wanting to know that. But we are working on a curriculum because we want to, there's lots of curriculums around, but we want to make one that is specific and in keeping with what we will teach as Seventh-day Adventists.
Thank you very much. And the next question is, what does it mean to socially transition?
Yeah, can I come on that?
Yes, Pastor Cavallo, yes.
Yeah. I'm very mindful that it may look completely different in the Department of Education wants us to see it in a different way. Here again, respectfully, you just have to take the first trans and then gender, then socially transitioning. They look different, but they're one and the same, in my view. One transgenderism, you have arrived. You are an adult. Okay. But social transitioning, really tailored to a child to reach transgenderism. Look, I'm not, I hope I'm not sounding hard. Just takes logic. Indeed, a child has not arrived because too many questions still in the head, but it is transitioning, going where? Backward, upward, downwards, forward. Hence, in our schools, which are which stand for biblical ethos and values, as rightly said by our education director, we'll be respectful in our response, but we'll leave no stone unturned. We will be intentional. I'm looking at 100 people out there. Listen to me. We will be intentional. Not just to second guess our children knows in the beginning God if we don't teach them. From Monday to Friday, they'll be, the best part of their minds will be taught something else. They come home late at night, eat dinner. We are in the same house, but in different bedrooms. Our process starts all over again. I'm saying intentional in the sense that I think, like our education directors put it, the families must be intentional to teach them relationships, but in the beginning, God. When they come to church, I'm happy of a general conference Sabbath school lesson, but it is general, not specific to England. Teach it, but in that home, find time to teach your children in the beginning God, so that when they go to school and they hear all this social transitioning, whatever, they can say, oh, I heard it at home. I heard it at home that God did what? Create man in the beginning, man and woman. But if you and I are not intentional now, they can't hear this at home. They can't hear it at church. They can't hear it in the Pathfinder. We are busy with other subjects. Whilst the school is talking about social transitioning, make no mistake. After a period, they will buy into this and say, Mama, where were you? Daddy, where were you? Pastor Cavallo, where were you? Good sermons. Even I'll be engaging with my fellow pastors. The last foolish thing to do is to go to children and say, by the way, we have been told in the school, we are being told, no, don't you do that. But do it privately. Pastor, families, begin to teach in your settings so that when they go to school, they'll even tell their friends, we can't socially transition because God has said this. So the ball is in the hands of the church, the family, and each one of us to put this right before they go to school.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'll move on to the third one, which is schools are now making all the concerns raised here mandatory in schools, regardless the age group of the children. Any guidance on how best to exempt our children? That is, if there's any policy guidelines to help us as parents.
Okay, I'll take this question. And just to let you know that every school, remember these guidance, they've just come out, and they're still in its draft stage, and therefore schools were doing how they felt. Hopefully this will give them some direction. But the RSC curriculum has been out for some time. It has been out in different forms. It used to be called SRE, Sex and Relationships Education, in times past, and now it's referred to Relationships RSE, Relationship Sex Education, or RSHE relationships in sex and health education. You may also hear it referred to as part of the PSHE curriculum, personal and social health education. So any guidance on how best to exempt our children? The guidance for in mainstream schools is as follows. What should have happened was when the curriculum, whichever form it came in, was brought into the school, there should have been a consultation process. That consultation process should have happened with governors, it should have happened with staff, and it should have happened with parents. So as parents, you should be aware, you can ask the question, what is being taught to my child in year three for relationships and sex education? That's the first thing that you can do. You have the right. You even have the right to ask to see the resources. I would like to see the resources that are being used. What videos will they be shown? What pictures will they be shown? You are allowed to do that. You are allowed to exempt your children, your child, from the elements of the curriculum that refer to sex education. That is the bit that you can exempt your child. And so when the school shows you the materials or the curriculum, they should be telling you as parents, these are the aspects of the curriculum, and there are various curriculums, schemes of work is the term that we use, various schemes, different. Not everyone's using the same scheme, but various schemes that are used, and they should be highlighting in our scheme, these are the areas of the curriculum for which you can exempt your child. What you can't exempt your child from are the bits about relationship. That's the bit you need to be careful of. Then the other thing to remind you of is there are relationships and sex education is taught in PSHE, as I mentioned, discreetly in RSE, but there may be elements that are taught in science. Now, you can't exempt from science. Yeah, you can't exempt from science. And it will normally be around about the elements that are taught in science will be about body parts and human, the older children, human reproduction. They look at animal reproduction and then they look at human reproduction again. So those are the bits that may be taught in science and so on. So you need to be clear from your school. If you haven't already done so, they should have consulted with parents, and they're supposed to do so on an annual basis, because this year I want to know about my child's, what they're learning in year three. Well, next year when my child is in year four, I also want to know what they're learning in year four. Therefore, you need to be asking on an annual basis, or if you want to ask for the whole curriculum from early years right through to year six in primary school, and the equivalent in secondary school, you need to ask for the curriculum. Ask for that. You have the right to see, but the bit that you can only exempt from is sex education. That's the bit that you can exempt from. I hope that answers the question.
All right. Thank you very much for that. Did I hear Professor Cavallo wanting to make a contribution to that?
Oh, no, just to
okay.
Really, yeah, be mindful that even legally, the schools have an obligation to consult you. Here again, my brethren, if you don't mind, my brothers and sisters, let us respond as if indeed they're true. They're consulting us, other than enter into this fight and flight mode. Either we just run away from something because it's horrible, or we want to fight it. Jesus says, do neither. Face the wolf, face the challenge. Who knows, God has brought you in those circumstances, not so much the issue only, but out of that issue, you are going to rightly represent the truth of God. To me, that's very paramount than just an exercise backwards and forwards with the government.
Okay, thank you very much. I have two more questions. One says, my son got in trouble at school for referring to a non-binary person as sir. The teacher requested to be called by gender-neutral titles like mixer or they. Is this against religious beliefs?
May I answer the question? I will first point to the guidance. Reminding you that the guidance has only just come out. Up until then, every school has been doing as they view. That is what's been happening. And this is why parents have been calling for the guidance, so that there is consistent guidance across all schools. So the guidance is well needed for this reason. But I want to read to you from page 13 on the guidance, and it talks about pronouns. For older children, schools do not need to specify pronouns to be used about each pupil and can decline a request to change a child's pronouns. So the school can decline that. The child might say, I want to be referred to as this and so on, but the school has the right to decline that. All right, so that might be the question. Someone was asking a question a bit later on about what do we do in our schools. Well, we can decline this. We don't need to refer to children as whatever pronoun they are preferring. But where schools have, and then it's not our schools, but where schools have on these rare occasions, no teacher or pupil should be compelled to use these preferred pronouns, and it should not prevent teachers from referring to children collectively as girls or boys. All right? So that's what the guideline is saying. No child should be, or teacher should be compelled to do. Now, the difficulty I had here, if I understand the person correctly, so they referred to the non-binary as sir. So I've got a feeling that they might have been talking to their staff, a staff member. Yeah, a staff member. And I think that where the guidance gives again, rather than saying sir, you might always say Mr. Jones. All right. Although he might want to be called Mr. Jones, so that might be a complication. But the guideline says, you do not need to refer, no one must be compelled or disciplined in this instance by referring, using someone's preferred pronoun. We do not have to do that. And is it blaspheming? My question is, that not blaspheming God? Well, we know what God has asked of us to do. Whether on a religious perspective, maybe Pastor Kavala might want to answer that question about blaspheming God.
I saw something coming through our human religious liberties. Not only Adventists have religious liberty, all other persuasions are entitled the same liberty which we must respect. But Human Rights Act 1998, which UK brought in from the European Convention of Human Rights, Article 9 gives you the right not only for worship, but what you stand for. But you see what they have done. There's a caveat to it. You will stand up for that right without any question, and that is called absolute right. But a caveat to that, they have made it qualified only if it does not trade on someone else. Yeah, if it trades on others, if your right trades on others, then it will be called into question. So you have an absolute right, but a qualified right. What I'll tell you, my brethren, it's now left to you. When it comes to qualified right, what you stood for God for, now you are being curtailed because of other circumstances. This is where Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego comes. They had a right. Listen to me. They had a right to worship God. But that right was curtailed. Listen to me. Was curtailed. That you have this right. If it does not step on Nebuchadnezzar or others, that is where the church, that is where the pastor friend will not stand up for you. You have to learn now to stand up on your own. Even if it means going into the fiery furnace and watch God what he will do. So don't ask me a question that I can give a yes or no. I know there is a religious liberty. I know that can be curtailed even now. It's left to you. Whether everyone else bows, I will stand up for that right. I repeat, that time, drip, 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 seems to be on us. And even when you stand up for what is right, look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, even Daniel in Babylon. That you don't hear them cursing the authorities, shouting at them, oh, this is the world of the what? They just connected with God. Quietly, they went into the lion's den. Quietly, without kicking a fuss, into the fiery furnace. Watch what God can do for your children, for your husband, for your family, for your community. If you stand up for God, courteously, respectfully, stand up. This consultation is not a fight or flight. Respond it courteously, but having read it through, respond by standing up for what you have been impressed, having put God first, logic second to the document, and those who you are talking to be a great witness for good.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Cavallo. I know we have less than 5 minutes, and I suppose in your last remark, I believe you have touched on some of the questions that have not been answered yet. There are quite a few of them. But I will say, you know, I'd like to apologize to those whose question couldn't come about because we had a limited time to address this. Perhaps last one, only a word. I suppose the previous question touches on this as well. If we use a child's preferred pronoun, are we not complicit in supporting their identity? Just a brief response.
Well, I think we've answered the question.
Yes, that's what I was saying.
To do so. We're not compelled to use the child's preferred pronoun. You do not have to do that, and no one should be chastised or disciplined for doing so. And the guidance makes that clear.
Great. Thank you very much. Now, incidentally, I have to say that we are bringing close this very useful and vital discussion that is in response to the government's consultation. And I believe all of you who have attended this will have something to fall on in terms of responding to the government's consultation. But the key thing is that please make sure that you respond before the deadline of the 12th of March. And also, if you can rally as many people as possible, it would be very, very beneficial to the cause, which is why we have in this consultation before the end times. So please go away and start rallying people to respond to this consultation based on the guidelines and also the advice that has been shared in this evening's discussion. I'd like to say thank you to all of you for taking the time on a Sunday evening to be part of this discussion. And may the Lord continue to bless you as we all raise our voices as citizens of the nation in terms of the impact that certain legislations will be having on us and our children. We have a voice because we're part of the bigger community. And democracy entails that those in government, those making laws, they're doing it on our behalf. And if we're going to be impacted, then we have a voice before it becomes a law or a legislation. And this is the time for one of those situations which is so critical. And so let's go ahead and fill the...
Sorry, Pastor, I just saw something about workshops in churches. Indeed, if there are those leading to the... of course, this was a good afternoon, but there may be those who would like us to visit their churches during the week or over the weekend, just to highlight on this, rally around, you know, yourselves. We'll be more than happy to leading up to the consultation, the workshop.
Indeed. Yeah. Thank you very much. And based on that, I would like to say thank you. Somebody had their microphone on. I would like to invite all of you for the closing prayer, benediction. If you can bow wherever you are, let us pray.
Pastor, can I just say one thing? Because we've had people ask it about getting this recording.
Yeah,
I believe it will be recorded or made available. Pastor Kavala, correct me if I'm wrong, on your YouTube page. Will it be made available there?
Okay, if folk will, definitely, yes. Yeah.
We had more than 100 people wanting to join. People were private messaging me saying they can't get on because the number was over 100. But once you got to 100, unless you've got that provision, we couldn't accommodate people over 100.
Oh, my apologies.
This is the situation. Just to let you know that we will make it.
Yeah.
Oh, we'll make it available.
And I've put
I know folk who are coming to the very end.
Yeah, yes. I've put my email address in there. For
I feel within myself, fog.
Yeah.
Like Shadrach, second Abednego, to the end. They were in Babylon. Make no mistake, they were not in Jerusalem. They were in Babylon, but not of Babylon.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus says, you are in the world, but not of the world. My prayer for myself, fog, is that I'll realize the challenges will be there, but God help me to be in this world, but not of it, but seeking to help others, the world to which God is preparing. It's my prayer.
Wonderful. Let me invite you to pray with me. Let's pray. Our gracious, loving Father, we bow to thank you once again for being with us as we discuss such a critical topic, an issue that has implications for us and our children, and also for the ministry we have here. Lord, we continue to seek wisdom from above as we deal with these issues. We pray you bless us with the appropriate responses. And Lord, we ask that you will also work with those who will be looking at this final consultation in terms of the responses, that they will deal with it in a way that makes provision for a religious liberty for all of us. Mm-hmm. And so, Father, we pray your blessings upon us and our ministries, and also in terms of our relationship with you. We also pray for those who are confused about the agenda, and we ask that your blessings will continue to abound, that all these individuals will experience your grace and your mercies, even as we also pray for them. Lord, we are grateful for your blessings and we thank you through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Still and Happy in Jesus, but to trust.